Morning, everyone. Welcome and thanks for coming. It's great to see we have a full house, and very gratifying to see that people are really interested in these events. As you all know, today's topic HDR and all things relating to that. We have the wonderful privilege to have the wonderful Phil Crawley with us, who is one of the most sort of enthusiastic people on this topic that I've ever met. And without any further ado, I'll hand you over to Phil. And so typically after the, Phil will pretty much take to the questions after the session, and our aim is to sort of wrap up and have everyone out of here just before 10. So thank you very much. Thanks, Phil.
When Graham says it's gratifying to see so many people, it worries me because there's so many clearly experienced and clever sort of heads in this room that I'm sure I'm going to get heckled by the end of this. So I'm basically going to gauge the mood of the room, and if you're an ugly mob, I'm going to just keep going. So there'll be no time for questions, but if you're gracious, then we'll have time for questions at the end. So high dynamic range for UHD / 4K television, that's our subject today. UHD, which we've all been talking about now for probably about 4 years, has had a few promises. Obviously, higher resolution is one of them, and that's probably the low-hanging fruit that's really been picked now. All the manufacturers have embraced 3840 or 4096 pixel wide lines. But the other things, such as wider colour gamut, higher frame rates, and high dynamic range, are still kind of all a bit in flux. You know, obviously we've got the P3, the DCI P3 colour space, but that comes from the digital cinema side of the industry, and so that's not, the compatibilities with television aren't so obvious. With Rec 709, our beloved high definition colour space that's been with us for sort of 25 years now. And standard dynamic range has obviously served us very well, but it's what we're going to be talking about today. And wide colour gamut, obviously Rec 2020 is the colour gamut we're aiming for, but there's only a couple of projectors that can currently do that, and all monitors are still limited to sort of 85-90% of Rec 2020. So it's still really all to play for. But I think really we have to think a little bit about history and how we've got this far. And this is a photograph I took at Ali Pali, near where I live, where the BBC first started their television broadcasts way back when. And it says, the world's first regular high-definition television service was inaugurated here by the BBC 2nd of November 1936. And you thought, flippin' heck, it was 2006 I got my Sky Plus box. I thought, that's where the HD started. But clearly it's been going on for a long time. And in fact, what it's referring to is electronic television. This is really where television started. The televisor, the Logibed televisor, which was a mechanical gadget, looks very Victorian, and that's because that's what it is. It's kind of rotating wheels and flashing lights and stuff. And if you've ever seen a televisor in action, there's loads of clips on YouTube, they're about 40 lines of resolution, and you can just about tell whether it's a man or a woman that you're looking at. And the BBC did broadcast this style. In fact, they did them in tandem for a while because they weren't quite sure which system was going to win out. I mean, if you believe that, they broadcast this system over the telephone network. This is a 2 kilohertz signal, and it's an audio signal that produces this picture. So television being broadcast over the same cables that bring your telephone service into your house, who would have thought that could have caught on? There we are. So a bit of a sort of a production delivery format sort of summary here. We've got that sort of pre-history, pre the Second World War, mechanical television. And I'm not sure there were ever any standards relating to that. But then 405 line television, just pre the Second World War and then after the Second World War. CCIR System A, that's got to be good, isn't it, as a standard. A gamma of 2.2, monochrome only, 50 interlaced fields. And then, sort of by the time the 50s roll around, we get to CCIR System B, again, a gamma of 2.2, monochrome television with 50 eye fields, but higher resolution. And then late 60s, we get 65 line PAL, CCIR System I. Again, a gamma of 2.2, but with a 4.43 megahertz subcarrier. And judging by the amount of grey hair in this room, you'll remember all this stuff, because I do very well. And of course, by the time the 80s came along, we're starting to call it Rec 601. That was the standard that kind of governed how we did digital video. And then come the 90s, we've got Rec 709, which defines our current world, of HD video. And again, an assumed gamma of 2.2, but that's not really the case, And it wasn't until 2011 when Rec 1886 actually defined the gamma for HD television. So the question is, what is so magical about this figure of 2.2, and why is it important? Well, way back when people were figuring out how to make electronic television work with big CRTs and the like, they realised that a CRT doesn't have a linear response. You know, as you pump voltage into the electron gun at the back of the tube, you don't get a linear light output response from that. It's a gamma function that looks like that. And because at the time there was no digital processing, I mean, there was no semiconductors at the time, they figured that to make this television system work and to be usable by a mass audience, they'd have to gamma correct at the camera end, where it's relatively easy to do it. There's not that many cameras in the world. And the millions of televisions at the other end would produce a linear light output for light input to the camera as a result. And, you know, there's the little, you know, light output is in proportion to the voltage raised to a certain power. And it just so happens that for cathode ray tubes, that power is 2.2. And that's why we've lived with it for so long. And so you can see there, we should define a couple of expressions here. The camera is a device that turns light into electrical signals, and it has an OETF, an optical to electrical transform function, essentially the red line there. And then the display is an electrical signal, which gets transformed into a light output. And that's an EOTF, electrical to optical transform function, which is the blue line there.
Because
one's in opposition to the other, we get a linear response, which is exactly what's wanted for a television system. Now, again, just another bit of a reminder. This is a slide from one of our fundamentals training courses. But, you know, how do television cameras work? Because it's not all black and white, of course. That stopped being the case in the 60s. Any device that makes pictures makes them RGB because of the way the eye works. You know, the designers of those early colour television systems had to ape the tri-stimulus nature of the human eye. And so, you know, you have this marvellous piece of optical engineering inside a television camera called a dichroic block, which splits the incoming light into three component pieces, with the red, the green and the blue. And if you've ever had to do any maintenance on cameras and you've had the chance to look at a dichroic block, you know, it's splendid. You hold it up and you say, oh, I can see the green image there and the red image there and the blue image there. And by gluing a CCD to each of these positions, you can derive three component signals. And we're all very familiar with that. Starts off RGB at the start of the production process. By the end of the production process, when it's coming out of the set-top box into your splendid, brand new OLED telly at home, it's been turned back into RGB so that it can light up the front of the telly and your eyes can see it, and you see, hopefully, a very faithful facsimile of what the camera was pointed at the start of the process. But of course, production workflows in television, for the most part, don't work that way. We work with YCBCR, or as you very lazy engineers call it, YUV. And so we typically distribute, or, you know, living inside files or whatever, that there's a luminance signal, which is akin to the original black and white signal, and two colour difference signals, the U, the blue colour difference signal, and the V. And, you know, just by counting all the number of bars, it's quite easy to see how they relate, the signal relates to the picture content. And of course, that transform going between YCBCR and RGB is governed by a set of numbers, as you'd expect. And every time, you know, Mr. Sony or Mr. JVC or whoever wants to build a monitor or a camera, they have to go and look at the book and they have to incorporate these numbers into their product. And essentially, when we say Rec 709 or 20 years ago when we said Rec 601, or in 5 years' time when we say Rec 2020, this is what those numbers dictate. You know, how our YCBCR components, either living in a file on an Avid shared storage system or traveling down an SDI cable, how they relate to RGB values. And you can go between YCBCR and RGB all day without any loss of quality. And it's only when we start, you know, bandwidth limiting the two color component signals that we compromise, you know, all the possibilities subsequently. But the important thing to remember from this is that grayscale fidelity is dependent on the linearity of the luminance channel, and grayscale fidelity is where people's eyes are drawn to. It's where colorists see, you know, casts, you know, in the grayscales. It's the most important part. And so it's why, you know, we kind of have to pay attention as we move towards an HDR future. Now, of course, we're no longer using CRTs. And every point in the production chain now has more than enough processing power to implement whatever response we choose. I mean, there's no good reason why a television camera should impose a gamma on the outgoing signal, because nothing else needs that gamma further upstream. Well, kinda, but you might think that the legacy of CRTs, which is now almost entirely gone, shouldn't really be with us. But actually, gamma still helps us in some ways. It's still useful. You know, our eyes don't perceive light the way cameras do. As the number of photons hitting a sensor in the back of a camera, the photon catch, as it's called, goes up. It receives twice the amount of signal, which gets turned into twice the voltage coming off the CCD, which is then digitized, and, you know, you've got the whole production chain after it. But we don't perceive that doubling as being twice as bright. We perceive it as being a bit brighter. It's a bit like audio. We don't have a linear response to audio changes in volume. It's a complicated relationship. And so it's that non-linear relationship, as things get brighter and brighter and brighter, that you know, our eyes don't perceive double, oh, you know, I can't see that kind of thing. It's far too bright. And that's exemplified by the fact that, you know, if you go out just as the sun's coming up in the morning and compare that to a bright midday sun, you might think to yourself, oh, it's twice as bright at midday. No, it isn't. It's probably 100 times brighter at midday if you were to take a light meter and do some measurements. So our eyes are not linear in that respect. And gamma-encoded images, that they encode grayscales more effectively, more efficiently. With a gamma response, you get a lot more from turning things into digits. And this diagram that I nicked from Cambridge in Colours website kind of shows that quite nicely. There we've got our nice continuous grayscale there, encoded with only 32 levels. If you were to encode it in a linear fashion, that's what you get. If you encode it with a 2.2 gamma, that's what you get. And it's a lot more, you know, where it counts down in the dark parts of the picture, you get a lot more finesse. Now, of course, 5 bits, nobody would use that for video, but the same is true at 10 bits and 12 bits and 14 bits, whatever your kind of camera's shooting at. There's a little interesting aside that I sort of sometimes say to people, and they don't quite believe it, is that obviously a modern camera with a CCD in the back, or even something like something that's based on SLR technology, like a D5 Mark II or something like that, 5D Mark II, with a CMOS sensor, they're both inherently analog devices. You know, the photons land on the sensor, they get turned into analog voltage, that gets digitized. The only digital image acquisition format that's ever really existed is film. Because if you think about the way a piece of film works, you've got those silver halide crystals embedded in the layers, the emulsion layers of the film. They can either fog or they don't. There's no grayscale in film. Film either, you know, goes dark or it doesn't. And so on a microscopic level, film is really the only digital acquisition format we've ever had. All the stuff that's come after it is entirely analog. Kind of interesting little aside. Anyway, enough of that.
Well, thank you, Aileen.
Gamma for TV. So it was really only 2011 when CMT EBU 1866 was ratified that we really, really defined what our gamma for high-definition television should be. Until then, everybody assumed it was 2.2, as it had been for, you know, a lifetime before that. But actually, it's a lot more complicated than that. 2.2 is kind of a good estimation, but actually, depending on the room, it's normally better to set your monitor to 2.4, particularly if you've got a room where you haven't got a well-controlled environment. So if it's an edit suite rather than a grading room, 2.4 is where you want your gamma to be. And Charles Poynton, who is, you know, he's forgotten more about colour and TV than I ever knew, he has a lot to say about that. If you go to his website, you can read all his stuff about kind of Rec 1886 and gamma for modern television production. Now, I'll often refer to Rec 709 when I really mean Rec 1886. Rec 709 defines our colour space and a few other things, our sampling structure and things like that. Rec 1886 is all about our gamma. And given that we're now talking about high dynamic range today, our gamma is what's important. So if I slip up and say Rec 709, take it as read that I actually mean Rec 1886. So there's point in. Shot my own joke a bit too soon. Poynton, ever since the birth of HD, ever since 1992, when Rec 709 was being, really Rec 709, not 1886, when Rec 709 was being ratified, he's talked about the fact we should have constant luminance. Now, what does constant luminance mean? Well, currently our television camera, so let's go back to our representation of our television camera, there it is. Currently our television camera applies the gamma correction at the three source signals, at the RGB. And then they're mixed and matrixed to make our YCBCR production format. And so long as it's all undone in the right order at the other end, you're good to go. But Poynton says there's a good case for not applying the gamma to the RGB components, but for applying it to the luminance once we've made the luminance. And that's because there's a degree of leakage between going between RGB and YCBCR, particularly when we start bandwidth limiting the two colour components down to half the bandwidth of the luminance components. In a perfect world, we would not apply the gamma correction at the RGB end, we'd apply it at the luminance end. And Poynton, for all his kind of shouting about this, has finally found favour, and Rec 2020 and Rec 2100, which kind of almost comes after that, they both have an allowance for constant luminance in future video systems going forward. Obviously, how does that then apply when we've got different gammas at our production end, when we're shooting on a Sony camera, when we're shooting on a Canon camera, and we don't have a 2.2 or a Rec 1886, to be more precise, gamma at the CMOS sensor, if we're shooting S-log or C-log. Maybe porn's making a rod for our own backs, but it does seem to be the way things should go. So here's a slide which is taken from our half-day sort of intro to colour course. And there's just two little things I want you to remember. So calibrating monitors for TV use, you're all familiar with the process. But the first two things, if I sit down in front of a TV monitor that I've got to get ready for editing or grading use, the first thing I do is I ask the colourist, is this how you have the room? This level of lighting? Because as when we set the overall blacks of the monitor, that's going to be affected. You turn the lights on after you've set the monitor, you'll notice the monitor now looks a bit more crushed. Or if we calibrate the monitor with the lights turned on and then we draw the curtains and turn the lights off, the monitor will suddenly sit up. And so you've got to calibrate the overall black response of the monitor in accordance with the brightness of the room. And so point one, set the overall black level plouge, the little plouge patch down here if you're using Simpty bars, so that the dark areas of the picture are faithfully reproduced. Stuff that's blacker than black, we don't want to see. Stuff that is slightly white, slightly greyer than black, we do want to see. So that's our first part of the process. And then the next thing we do is we set the peak white of the monitor to around 100 candelas per meter squared. That's what the EBU say. If you go to the BBC, they say 80 candelas per meter squared. Some film people like 60 candelas per meter squared because obviously it's easier on the eye for a long day of grading. But something in that order, 100 candelas per meter squared for the peak white of the monitor. And then the other stuff is kind of why you've paid silly money for Route 6 to come and calibrate your monitor. So just bear those two things in mind, the little blue highlight and the little yellow highlight, setting the overall black level, setting the overall peak white level. So, gamma with non-TV cameras. For many years now, we've been used to people shooting things in S-log, S-log 3, C-log, C-log 2, or scanning film using Cinian log response, 12-bit Cinian log, something like that. So we're very comfortable with having non-TV gammas in a TV workflow. And of course, the brilliant thing that brings to the party is that now the colorist has a load more latitude to play with. You look at it on a Rec 709 monitor, and you think, well, these pictures look very washed out, very sort of pasty and pale, and not like nice TV pictures should do. Was the Rec's engineer having a day off that day sort of thing? But no, these were shot with a different gamma. And so before you've actually applied whatever grading effect you want to apply, in base light, in resolve or whatever, the pictures will look strange. But of course it gives the colorist a lot more latitude to pull things out of the blacks or to maybe pull down the whites and be assured that he can still find detail in the clouds or in the bright parts of the picture. And these two images here just kind of show what happens when you try and force a C-log response, clearly a funny looking gamma, into a Rec 709 LUT. And there will be occasions when you have to apply a LUT to something shot with a non-television gamma, just for viewing copy, just for review and approval, those kind of things. Now, given that we've had alternate gammas for a while, what's the kind of the state of play with the industry's favourite editing application at the moment with Media Composer? So this is some material that myself and Dave Skeggs, one of my colleagues, shot for BVE this year. And we pleaded with both Avid and Canon, whose HDR monitors we sell. Have you got any good show-off material that we can show to customers at a trade show? No, nothing. Nothing we can give you, kind of thing. It's all client material. So we went out and we borrowed a C300 Mark II, set it into HDR mode, C-Log 2 mode, and pointed it up Tottenham Court Road. And the thing that these are photographs taken off the front of a Canon DPV 3010 high dynamic range monitor. The thing that struck me was in the darkness of a winter evening, I can see detail inside the headlights on this taxi. I can actually see, if you look, this is getting shot on a pocket camera and then projected via a PDF kind of thing, but you really can see detail inside the headlights of that taxi. And then on exactly the same still frame shot, I can see details in the trees, in the darkness above the bus there. And so, splendid, that gives our colorists lots of options. And the way Avid deals with that is Avid knows about non-TV gammas. And so when you drop things on the timeline, you import them into a bin, you drop them on the timeline, looking at them on the GUI, you know, the playback monitor, you know, your right-hand monitor on the Avid, things do look quite kind of lacking in detail. Everything's blown out. There's no detail on the blacks or whatever. But at least if you have an HDR monitor, you can see what was there when it was shot. And you obviously have to tell Avid this is an HDR project. And Avid has a rather splendid facility where it can collapse down things in the source bins to what they would look like if they were X709. And so the next image is, again, shot off the set front of the same monitor, but with the monitor now in Rec 1886 mode, so HD television mode. And you can see, again, we've lost all the detail in the blacks, we've lost all the detail in the whites, and that's what a regular Rec 709 television camera would give us if in that same situation. So it's kind of encouraging that things like Baselite and Avid have fully embraced this idea of maintaining those weird gammas through the production workflow so that we can then look at them on a monitor that knows about that production workflow. Now, a year ago when we started to get into this, it was a complete crapshoot. You were either shooting on a Sony camera, an F55, an F65, and grading on an X300, a Sony 25 grand HDR monitor, or you were doing the same thing with Canon. And they didn't really kind of, there was no real crossover. Now, thankfully, as of IBC, Sony monitors support many more alternate gammas, and Canon monitors do as well. Although, interestingly, they don't actually say, you know, when you call up the menu in a Canon monitor, it doesn't actually say S-Log, it says User Log 1 or something like that, but it is S-Log. So that's really, I suppose, the beginning of an HDR world. The fact that we've got cameras that can shoot with a lot with more stops of dynamic range than they previously could. And we've been happy with that in standard dynamic range workflows for a while. You know, people are more than happy to sort of get their heads around that. But of course, now we're in a position where we have consumer displays and professional displays that are capable of much, much brighter light outputs. Remember, 100 candelas per meter squared is typically what a colorist is looking at for peak white when he's grading a show or a film or whatever. But it's been a long time since you've been able to buy a telly in PC world that only does 100 candelas per meter squared. They all do, thinking 300, 400 candelas per meter squared peak white. And increasingly, we're starting to look towards displays that can do much, much, much brighter than that. 10,000 candelas per meter squared is what's within the latitude of Dolby PQ, for example, one of the HDR systems we're going to talk about now. So we have our production formats from several manufacturers. You know, Sony, they have a couple of alternate logs you can shoot at if you want more dynamic range. Canon, again, they have a couple. Panasonic, in fact, pretty much any camera you shoot on now, you can use funky high dynamic range gammas. And that's because all these cameras are 12-bit, 14-bit sensors that are capable of just so much more latitude than previously you would have got for 10-bit television camera. And really the principle is that you're concentrating the bit depth, you're concentrating all those digital codes where you want them so that the extra range is apparent. We're not so fussed about stuff in the midpoints, we're really very sensitive to stuff in the dark areas of the picture. And we want the bright areas of the picture to pop. We want the specular highlights, as they're called, to really assault our senses. And if you've seen much of the demo footage that people like Sony are hawking around trade shows, you come to the conclusion that from now on, all television is going to be shot at nighttime near large bodies of water. that's where you see specular highlights the best, you know. Hong Kong Harbour will suddenly become the new place to shoot every TV show. Your modern expensive grading displays, a Sony BVM X300 or a Canon 3010, the V3010, the one that we sell, 9,000 euros cheaper than the Sony, I have to say. And probably a better monitor as well.
I think Phil's in today. Phil Moss has come today, so you're right there.
And obviously domestic OLEDs are kind of leading the way. Now, there's an interesting thing. I saw Poynton talking MPC a couple of weeks ago. And if you ever get the chance to hear him, he's a very interesting fellow. But one of the things he said was, we have to get to OLEDs for HDR, because although you can build an LCD screen with an LED modulated backlight to do these huge luminance outputs. The problem with it is that those tellies are taking 3, 4, 5 times the amount of power than just a regular standard dynamic range telly if you're doing it with LCDs, because you've really got to drive that backlight. And he'd done a calculation for the whole of America, and he said that if half of Americans change their television in the next 10 years, which apparently is an industry thing, that's kind of a common thing, America will need to build 2 more nuclear power stations to service the HDR requirements. winking Three Mile Island all over again, just for specular highlights. And so we have to get to OLEDs for this, because OLEDs can do this efficiently, LCDs can't. There have been a few SMPTE EBU standards relating to high dynamic range, but the one that really seems to be settling in, and it was really kind of only ratified since the summer, what we did this presentation at our Glasgow office earlier in the year, and we couldn't talk about REC 2100 because it hadn't been ratified. But REC 2100 is the standard that kind of really ratifies two HDR production stroke deliverable standards, and that's the BBC NHK hybrid log gamma system and Dolby Vision stroke Dolby PQ. Dolby Vision is the sort of the overall product description for all Dolby's high dynamic range offerings. Dolby PQ is the 10-bit television workflow system, which supposedly is licensing unencumbered, but if you believe that about Dolby, you'll believe anything. So REC 2100 supersedes REC 2020 in defining the resolutions for UHD, 4K, 8K, wide color gamut, high dynamic range, and high frame rates. But interestingly, it defines how you handle specular highlights, which is really where we're going with HDR. The point I've made at the bottom here, blacks cannot be made any blacker. So if I want more dynamic range, where do I go? Well, I have to have the bright parts of the picture being much, much brighter. And so again, Dolby PQ allows for 10,000 candelas per meter squared. What is that? That's like 100 times brighter than what a colorist looks at. But the get out there is that basically anything over about 500 candelas per meter squared is considered specular highlights, and it's over only small parts of the picture. It's the twinkling stars in the sky. It's the reflections off the water on Hong Kong Harbour. It's all those things that really make a picture come alive. And for most people, HDR actually gives a better experience of television than 4K resolution does. It's kind of the thing that really we should have started with that UHD rather than 4K. And a lot of manufacturers have sold a lot of 4K televisions that only do REC 709, that only do standard dynamic range, and that only do a maximum of 30p. You can understand why the public are kind of upgrade averse. They're constantly being sold things that really weren't the full measure. The first time I had to calibrate an X300 for HDR, I was taken by surprise. I was doing a bunch of other things, and this one needs to work for HDR. So a quick phone call to Sony, and their advice to people who are setting up monitors is that you set a 50% white level at 100 candelas per meter squared. So previously, what would have been our mid-grey 50%, we set it at 100 candelas per meter squared, which would previously be in our peak white. And you make sure that is correct from a colorimetry point of view. You do your 5% gray, which is the standard. This is if you're doing a front of the monitor calibration rather than profiling the monitor and producing a LUT to make it right. And you just kind of hope that everything above 500 candelas per meter squared, or everything over 100 candelas per meter squared, up to those specular highlights at whatever they are, 1,000 candelas on an expensive grading monitor, that the kind of the RGB grayscale tracking is correct. So again, it's a little bit kind of ad hoc, where's this kind of going? So those observations, I suppose, really apply to the production, the acquisition, and the post-production side of things. But deliverables, of course, is where everybody's kind of fretting. How do I deliver to Netflix, to Amazon? And when it finally comes, how do I deliver to broadcast television for HDR? Or how do I even make things that will have some ongoing value because they were shot with a high dynamic range? I've archived them accordingly. The BBC system, or BBC NHK co-developed system, Hybrid Log Gamma, is a scene-referred system, and we'll get to that in a moment. Just like conventional television, the signal represents relative light levels of the original scene, which allows pictures from a single mastering process or live production to be adapted to the same artistic effect on bright or darker screens at home. Only the display itself needs information about its own capabilities and environment to faithfully render the scene-referred signal. So metadata that describes the mastering display is not required. HLG, Hybrid Log Gamma, also has native compatibility with standard dynamic range television with the same colour format, which can be used for ultra-high definition displays. So there's the kind of graph that shows you the difference. There's an arbitrary sort of linear light scale across the bottom, and then again an arbitrary signal value across at the y-axis. But the reason broadcasters are kind of quite sort of like enamoured with all this is that it doesn't break their existing 10-bit SDI production chains. you know, you can put this in at the start of a 10-bit production chain and be assured that all the equipment through the process can deal with these signals. And so the way hybrid log gamma works is pretty much to 2/3 of the light levels, there's not much difference. It's only when you get past that this new gamma curve deviates from Rec 709 and Rec 1886, I should say, and allows us to have much greater latitudes in the bright parts of the picture. Now, the benefits of this are again, you know, your existing plant is not made redundant. Conversion between standard and high dynamic range material is not hard because you've only got to worry about those specular highlights and all that kind of stuff. Obviously, productions have to be aware of what they're shooting for, and you would hope that the racks engineer in the OB truck or in the studio is looking at a high dynamic range monitor so they can make the best of the pictures they're getting. But the intention is this allows much better compatibility with the previous standard dynamic range. This is a point that's worth making. We've got about 14 stops of dynamic range in our eyes. Standard dynamic range video has a dynamic range of about 6 stops, and that's kind of historical, relating to, you know, noise in the blacks and things like that. That's kind of what comes out of your set-top box, what you can, you know, you're looking at home with all the MPEG noise embedded into it and such. Pro standard dynamic range video, the kind of stuff that, you know, is coming out of the OB truck, you know, you could pretty much say has a 10 stops of dynamic range, you know, if you're talking in photography terms. What they discovered, you know, in tests, hybrid log gamma on 1,000 candela per meter squared display with a bit depth of 10 bits, so still the same, you know, SDI standard that's been used for HD video up until now, has a dynamic range in the order of 17 and a half stops, which is kind of pretty impressive, you know, that's a very nice upgrade. You know, and there's this compatibility, and very nicely, it's also supported in HEVC. And has been from the start of H.265. The BBC had quite a hand in that. So, you know, all the kind of things you'd want for something that's deliverable over DVB or over, you know, over the top services, things like that, HLG is ideal for it. Now, along comes Mr. Dolby, you know, we've all got our opinions about how Dolby behave, but, you know, licensing is their first and last consideration. They have a wider set of products for high dynamic range, and Dolby PQ, the perceptual quantizer, is their HDR technology for television. HLG is what they refer to as a display referred system. So I should really wind back and say what we mean by scene referred system. So a scene referred system basically says, here's the image that the camera's looking at, and we don't consider that the video that we're producing to have any dimensions to it. It's not, you know, the video numbers that are coming down the SDI cable or that are sitting in the file on the Avid timeline. Those numbers are relative brightness levels. They're not absolute dimensioned values. It's not like you can say that you know, SDI value 316, you know, relates to, you know, 20 candelas per meter squared. It's not. It's a scene referred system, and that's probably the case. You know, from a philosophical point of view. When I first started at the BBC, I worked at Lime Grove Studios, and the practice at Lime Grove was to have the camera control, the lighting gallery, where the lighting director and the camera engineer, the racks engineer, sat on the same level as the studio floor, and you'd open the door and you could look out at the things you were racking your camera for. And I kind of thought, well, that's kind of what scene referred isn't it? You know, we're racking our video to match what we're seeing with our eyes. It's a scene referred system. Dolby says, no. All video is display referred because at every point in the production chain, you're looking at it on a display, you know, and you have to relate light levels to digital values. And so when you master something using Dolby PQ as your gamma curve, you're saying, these digital video levels relate to these light levels. Now, that might be fantastic for a controlled environment like a viewing theatre or a cinema where you go to watch a blockbuster, but is that really the case? Is that really how we watch television? We watch television in bright kitchens, in dark living rooms, on portable devices, on the tube. There's no control over the ambient light around the device we're watching television on, and there's no control as to how brightly we wound up that device. there's no control over the fact that, you know, I bought a 1,000 candela per meter squared LG television this year, and in 2 years' time I'm buying a Samsung one that works at 2,000 candelas per meter squared for peak whites. But yet Dolby says, no, this peak white level that you've mastered with, you've mastered 1,000 candelas per meter squared for peak white in this scene, that's what it is. That just doesn't seem to fit into a world where people don't watch television in the same way that they watch movies. I don't know, perhaps I'm missing something, but it doesn't seem that PQ is a good fit for the way television is made and watched. An interesting thing about PQ is it relies on the EDID in the monitor to convey back to the playback engine what the peak white value of the monitor is capable of. So there's the things I've just been banging on about, and you know, why I think Dolby PQ is perhaps not the answer to high dynamic range television currently. Interestingly, Rec 2100 ratifies both. It says that both BBC HLG, BBC NHK HLG, and Dolby PQ are good for DVB, and that's like a specification that's a month old. So, you know, as we start to move towards terrestrial and, by extension, satellite delivery, because Sky are getting behind HLG, we'll start seeing, I think, HLG as the preferred mastering standard for broadcast deliverables. And, you know, there's my little quibbles there, which I've already banged on about.
Well, Sony have got behind HLG as well. They've got a full-blown yes. transmission chain, haven't they?
Absolutely. So really the last thing I wanted to sort of like throw at you is not television. This is the ASUS, well, maybe it is. This is the ASUS workflow for cinema production. And it's something that the Academy have been working on for 10 years. And it's meant to be an all-encompassing production system that allows multiple different camera types, everything from kind of GoPros all the way up to, you know, whatever Red or Alexa produce next kind of thing, to work seamlessly with each other. Including you know, CGI rendered imagery within a unified workflow, and some bits of software are starting to encompass this. Resolve, for example, is kind of ASUS through and through. there's some interesting things about it. The color primaries of the ASUS color workflow system, they're defined as all of our colorimetry is on the CIE 1931 chart. They're RGB primaries, not XY, which is where DCI has been all these last 10 years. And interestingly, although they're RGB primaries, they're outside the spectral locus, so they're non-realizable colors. They're colors that you couldn't see, you know, which is kind of a bit of a, you know, fiddle with your mind kind of thing. But in a sense, we're kind of used to that in audio, for example. Yeah, we often digitize much, much higher than the audible band, because we want to be able to maintain the ability to do things with audio later on. But yeah, so the color primary definition for ASUS is outside the spectral locus for the RGB primaries. And so we've got, you know, everything that's possible kind of thing. The white point is at D60, the same as DCI-P3, you know, the digital cinema color space. And ASUS compatible compliant files are encoded in what they call 16-bit half floats. So it's a 32-bit number with 16 bits for the integer and 16 bits for the mantissa. And there are various ways in which the integer and the mantissa relate to high dynamic range content. But, you know, you've got a notional 33 plus stops of scene referred relative exposure within those files. So you kind of think whatever comes next, you know, should be supported by this for the next 100 years kind of thing. You know, and by these very sort of definitions, ASUS supports high dynamic range and wide color gamuts. But not many cameras and projectors conform to these ideas. You know, these are not real, physical, realizable things. And so you have to have this thing called the ASUS color workflow, where images come in at the left-hand side there, and they pop out at the digital projector on the right-hand side, or maybe something else. You know, it doesn't have to be a projector. And so we've got this concept of an IDT, an input device transform, which equates very nicely to our old-school OETF, our optical to electrical transform function. But of course, this is transforming a file. You know, this is not dealing with video at all. And so that conforms whatever camera you're shooting on, everything from a modest little GoPro to whatever the most amazing kind of digital cinema camera might be, that conforms them all to a common standard, a common gamma, a common color space, so that we're kind of off to a good start. Now, of course, rendered material, CG material, you know, your rendering engine, whatever that is, you know, whatever renderer you're using has to know about ASUS. But so long as it does, you can render your computer graphics straight into the ASUS definition. And, that's considered, you then produce material, rendered graphic material, that works with your camera footage. And in fact, if you think about archive, the ASUS standard is where your archive would live as well. Mm. Then we have another step called the reference rendering transform, which widens out the gamut and the dynamic range in preparation for any possible output device or output file format. And we finally wind up with the output device transform, very akin to our EOTF, if we're thinking about video, that produces something that will look correct on an output device. Now, I nicked this image from Mystica's website. And this is very interesting, because look at this. They've got an ASUS source, you can consider that your archive or your production workflow, 4K, 32-bit floating point, 16-bit half floats. And look at all their ODT sort of images there. We're preparing stuff for over-the-top delivery, for regular Rec 709 delivery, for IMF, if you're delivering to Netflix or Amazon, or DCP. And who would have ever thought we'd see DCP sitting on the same level as all those guys? But that's a very interesting slide, because maybe ASUS is the workflow to rule them all. Maybe this is the one that will IMF perhaps isn't the last word in all of this. Perhaps ASUS is the way this will all go. So I just found that very interesting. So just finishing up, here are some resources that you might like. Michael Toon's book, Colour Reproduction in Electronic Imaging, is my go-to book. It's the best thing I've read relating to electronic imaging. Steve Shaw has got a fantastic article on his website on Lightspace. On Light Illusion. He's the guy behind Lightspace CMS, which is the colour management software we use. So if you get Route 6 into Bruce and Lutz for you, it's Lightspace that we'll be doing it with. Excellent primer on UHD and HDR. Poynton, again, one of my heroes, very extensive notes on where gamma's kind of gone and where it's taken us as far as HDR goes. Scott Miller's article in the Symptom Motion Imaging Journal from last month is 2 months ago, worth a read. If you don't get the Simpty Journal, I encourage you to join and read that. Mm-hmm. Tim Borer of the BBC, again, he is a guru in all this stuff. And if you look at the stuff he's got on BBC's R&D website, very interesting. Broadcaster ran an article last week about how the DVB are readying for HDR. And again, it's they're readying behind Rec 2100, which is both Dolby PQ and Hybrid Log Gamma. And there's the ASUS documentation website and Dolby Vision's website. So all very good reading. And we will stick these notes as well as a recording of this on the Route 6 blog in the next couple of days. And that's also a great resource. There's lots of good stuff on there written by myself and Graham and Matt and Rupert and lots of others. There we go. What time is it now? I've nearly overshot my time, but I think we've probably got time for some questions if you want.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Cheers, Phil. I understood most of that. Remarkable. But not all, it has to be said. I think you lost me on the Maltesers.
Yeah.
Right. Anybody got any questions?
It will be interesting to know, is anybody delivering HDR at the moment? And what's your workflow?
ASUS.
Right, okay. And that's for what? For this is for DCI or?
Mixture of some projects as well as commercial.
And so what's your grading?
On the film jobs, that's all ASUS.
Right, but what software are people using to grade?
Oh, mostly ASUS.
Right, okay. Yeah, I mean, Baselite are always early to the party with these things. They always seem to support things quite quickly.
Well, somebody must have a question. Don't be shy. Get your feet wet. Shall I ask one? So, Phil, what in terms of fitting the kind of the wide number of stops you can acquire in modern cameras into essentially the sort of the log workflow. I mean, that's been around forever, as you say. I mean, it's interesting that, do you want to expand a bit on what the difference between the various approaches people or manufacturers have taken to that are? So why, you know, Sony felt inclined to produce S-Log or Canon C-Log, or what magic they're working that isn't, you know,
well, I mean,
generic.
You know, video's been turned there for an awful long time, you know, decades, and since the late 80s, I suppose, or early 90s. And if you're a camera manufacturer who's produced a camera in 2008 or whatever, and you think, my word, I've got a 12-bit sensor in this camera, you know, what am I doing messing around with these video boards? And so there's a lot, makes a lot of sense, doesn't it, to write your files where you can put the dynamic range where it's needed.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why cameras have funny looking, you know, logarithmic responses and not a nice smooth. Because I mean, you know, you could go through most of your career as a TV engineer kind of forgetting about log, because pretty much all the time you see video, you never see it in its log response. You see it, you know, after the waveform monitor is corrected for that, or after the you know, TV monitor is corrected for that, or, you know, after it's been imported into something and you're looking at the numbers, you know. So it would be very easy to go through your career as a TV engineer never being aware of this, only that you occasionally see it, you know, when idiots are standing in front of a projector banging on about it. But so most of us kind of think of video as being linear, don't we? Mm-hmm. You know, that's our thought process.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of, I suppose, non-intuitive that you should have, you know, something that looks like that, let alone something that sort of does that, you know. And the reason they call it S-log is it kind of looks like an S if you look at it with your head skewed. You know, and you know, Sony have got numerous variations, you know, because you know, it makes sense to be able to offer the DOP who's setting up a bunch of possibilities, you know, and it's why you might need a LUT on set to make a Rec 709 monitor give you a faithful reproduction. It's something that we've seen a bit of with the Fuji IS mini LUT boxes on some OBs. People use those to give the Rec 709 electronic sort of broadcast output for the truck, knowing full well they're recording the F55 outputs, you know, in the native S-Log 3 format.
But all of them essentially are just a choice as to where you're going to put the code values that are too large to display in the image that you are
yes.
displaying.
Yeah, absolutely. You've got this beautiful analog signal coming off the sensor, which is, you know, reflective of the light that went through the lens, through the dichroic block, hit the sensors, and then you've got to pack that down into 1,000 values.
Mm.
Well, 960 something values. You really want to put them where they visually look the best, where it gives you the most bangs for your buck.
Yeah. Mm. Okay.
Got a question here. The high dynamic range is obviously the way to go forward and to make things more interesting for watchers at home. But given that the difficult part seems to be the moment, it's not the capturing it or processing it, but actually delivering it. What do you think will be, just having a look around, you know, gazing at what's happening at the moment, who do you think will be first to get it into people's homes, and how will that happen? Because in my mind, it's quite a big step for that to happen. Obviously, people have got to buy new tellies.
Yeah.
That's not so hard, maybe, but actually getting it onto people's tellies in a broadcast, not a narrowcast. Who do you think will?
Well, I think the people who lead the way will not be the broadcasters. It'll be the over-the-top deliverers. So it'll be Netflix, the Amazons, and
it's already done.
Amazon,
can watch Top Gear or Grand Tour, it's called, HDR. Ironically, it appeared a little late. I'm not quite sure why that was, but at midnight you could download the HD version, but then I think a little bit later the HDR version popped up.
Is that realistically only the way forwards at the moment is for to be done as a download?
There are various NDAs that prevent us talking about other things, but no, there are.
The DVB consortium have only 2 weeks ago, you know, ratified, you know, they've said, yes, we're going to go behind Rec 2100. And so presumably the next iteration of DVB, DVB T3, or whatever it might be called, that will say, you know, that there'll obviously be MPEG metadata markers in the stream that says this program stream here is, you know, Rec 2020 color or P3 color or whatever, and it's HDR conforming to the BBC hybrid log gamma system. And then your set-top box will have to say, ah, I know about that.
Mm.
And I know what flags to set on the HDMI cable going up to the back of the telly. And so long as the telly knows about it, the telly will be able to say, yes, I know what to do with those values.
And that ironically is probably the challenge, is that a lot of tellies, as Phil said, are in the marketplace and are capable of, you know, wider gamma and brighter, you know, higher nits than you're currently set them to. What the broadcasters, I think, are relying on, possibly slightly optimistically, is the television manufacturers enabling the existing tellies to do HLG when they're trying to flog you a new one. That politically or commercially may or may not take place. I suspect the pressure will be on them to do the right thing, but you can imagine the conversations in boardrooms at Sony and LG as to whether that would be a commercially sensible thing to do. But HLG is absolutely designed to deliver to existing equipment. And I think some of this came from that realisation. I think there are some broadcasters who aren't necessarily constrained with transmitting over Freeview. They've got their own boxes or whatever, have been looking at televisions and their capabilities for some time, going, blimey, they've got a wider colour gamut, they've got a higher brightness capability. Why don't we take advantage of that and make that a commercial advantage? And I think that's probably...
I saw a great demo led by Tim Borah from the BBC, and they showed the same HLG encoded material on a Sony PDM A250, which is Rec 709 3&3 monitor, and on an X300, and you can tell that it's not quite the full measure on the A250, but it's very watchable, and on the X300 it really pops, and looks great.
I mean, we accidentally sort of set up our own kind of comparison. We went to the thing in Manchester recently where we had the Canon HDR monitor next to a Boland 709 monitor, and we had the same output from an Atomos recorder. And fortunately, not deliberately, but they had a kind of fluorescent orange wrap on the little occasional tables, which we had the camera trained on. And it was really noticeable. The Canon monitor, it looked like what you were looking at. So you turn, but like Phil was saying, scene referred, and that's what it looked like. You look at the 709 monitor and it looked really very unlike what you were looking at. So it became kind of very clear to the kind of to the casual viewer what the difference between 709 and HDR really is. And it is more like looking out the window. You didn't touch on HDR10 at all, Phil. Is that
HDR10 is
painted out of history, mate.
No. HDR10 is the non-Dolby trade name for PQ in domestic receivers. So 10-bit, HDR10 10-bit is what Mr. Samsung will put on his marketing material, Mr. LG will put on his marketing material.
Right.
Any other questions, folks?
Yeah, just touching upon the deliverables. So when we delivered IMF to Netflix, at the moment it's been a DPX sequence from the post house into a clipster, make an IMF package, out it goes. Is that going to change at all? I mean, is it basically we'll get an ASIS encoded or a REC 2020 encoded DPX sequence?
In due course, potentially, ASIS is taking quite a while to kick in the UK. I know the farm have been using it for Top Gear, Grand Tour. And there's some debate as to whether or not there's sort of people like Phil who are purists who are kind of pushing it because it's the right thing, and then there's people who are trying to get the job done and out the door who are going, this is taking far too long. I think as the tools appear to make it easier, quicker, more widespread, it will eventually become.
And will we be able to do that conversion in something like Clipster, or will we have to pre-process it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, ASIS is not yet supporting Clipster, but it will be soon. I mean, the Americans
are pretty proactive.
The Americans are very big on it, because obviously the Hollywood studios, it makes a massive amount of sense, and that's where it came from. In Europe, it's always been a little bit kind of, why do we need this? But I think as Phil's demonstrated there, it does, in a purist sense, look like it's a sensible idea. But obviously, in a practical sense, you've got to have all the equipment and indeed the staff who understand it. And you've got to make sure all the manufacturers' IDTs and ODTs exist.
Yeah.
And then when they exist, they're accurate.
So you're still getting the same, you're still receiving and sending out the same file formats. It's just they're coded with that colour, that white colour.
Yeah, I mean, where it kind of makes sense is it's a sort of a kind of safe space, as it were. Everything inside of ASIS is theoretically the same, and therefore you're kind of operating in a common environment, aren't you?
Yeah, everything's kind of bought into one place, made compliant with each other, and then that allows you to then flow out to these really disparate kind of deliverable formats,
But with a sort of a common transform.
Yeah.
I mean, what it should theoretically remove is the need to kind of keep flipping it from one colour space to other, and in and out of YUV, RGB, all the rest of it, which tends to take place at the moment in the post-production workflow without a great deal of design, shall we say.
Just bump it to one.
So the idea is, everything. I mean, interestingly, one of the things that somebody told me about Hollywood Post or the sort of Los Angeles world is that the productions are very much more powerful, if you like, than in the UK. And where in the UK post-production companies, you tend to find them say, yeah, we have a mezzanine format of X. That's what we work in. You know, our shared storage has mostly got, you know, this file format, whatever. That's much less the case in the States. So I think ACES possibly reflects that reality, wherein you kind of put everything into ACES, you kind of de facto create that scenario in Hollywood, which doesn't kind of commercially, it hasn't happened. Whereas commercially in the UK, for whatever reason, and I guess in Europe, the post-production companies have been slightly more dominant, if you like, and have imposed, you know, a mezzanine format on their customers as they bring in their, you know, heterogeneous file formats. Yeah, they all get transcoded into whatever the house file format is. So in some senses, the reason ACES isn't quite as obvious here is we're kind of already doing a sort of version of it, which is putting everything into a common format for post-production purposes and then squirting it out for whatever kind of file format converter you've got.
We need to wrap up.
Do we?
It's nearly 10.
What time do we... Have we got, did we get kicked out?
Well, no, we won't, but
we'll get everyone away. Does anybody else have any more burning questions?